Good morning, Nerd Fam, and welcome to Google Cloud Next here in fabulous Las Vegas, Nevada. We are here on day one, kicking off our 3 days of coverage, over 30 fantastic segments, upward of 50 guests coming for you this week. My name's Savannah Peterson, joined by the best in the business on the desk this morning. We've got Dave, we've got John, and Paul. Gentlemen, next time, text me about the blue blazers.
I know, right?
Jeez. Hey,
blue's the color of the day.
Oops.
Yes, it's all right, it's all right. We'll work
on
that.
I hit the thrift shop, by the way.
Hey!
Expensive as hell.
So, yes, well, good thrifting
can be. I think I went into
be.
The real by
mistake. Yeah, yeah. well, we'll continue that conversation. We'll get your daughter on to talk about proper thrifting at some point. The show just kicking off here on the expo floor, however, there has been a lot of events already. I know the analyst day yesterday involved a Wizard of Oz immersion at the Sphere. Paul, you've had the hot takes all week, and I know you've been on the ground for a bit. What are you seeing so far to kick us off this week?
Well, I mean, it's all about the announcements. Lots of excitement going on right now. It's the show floor is crazy. 30,000+ of my closest friends are here, so it's pretty crazy. Just walking back and forth to the keynote was an adventure in itself. But you know, AI, of course, optimized AI and platforms top of mind. We have multi-cloud, distributed cloud environments. That's also top of mind, and then interoperability. Right, that's a big factor that you're seeing at the show. That from a high level, that's really where it's really coming down to.
I think you're absolutely right. I think we're going to be having a lot of those conversations here. John, I know you were listening to the keynote, and you as well, Dave. Keen to hear, what was the announcement that stood out to you the most?
I mean, to me, the big thing was they have a whole vision around the stack of AI, and it's basically AI everywhere in all the apps, everywhere all at once kind of thing. All their apps are going to be infused with AI. I think last year we said that. AI infused everywhere, so that was the kind of like one thing that was clear. But the thing was the Ironwood TPU announcement was the big thing that showed massive investments in CapEx. This year, I think they quoted to have, I think, $45 billion this year, seventh generation TPU at Ironwood. Next gen networking opening up their global distributed network that's Google only to enterprises, that's going to be a big deal. They quoted Citadel and some other customers there that are going to get a 40% reduction in cost of ownership. And then they talked about quantum, the quantum chips. And so I found that interesting. So Jensen wasn't on stage, he did a remote appearance, but I think the infrastructure advancements this year was definitely one that they needed to do. And the rest you kind of got to fill in, squint through. There's a lot of little point examples of customers, but for the most part, they're like moving the needle inch by inch, but then the big needle mover will be the infrastructure advancements.
I think you bring up a good point there, John. I just want to highlight quantum making its way back into the conversation. We sort of had AI coming up here, then both things, then if we look at supercomputing and looking at the real high performance computing going on around the world, frankly, and now it's coming back. So
I mean,
I'm curious to see.
We had an interview last week. People say that you get to 1 million qubits to kind of get the chip. And so you start to see, fabs, chips being built with quantum, major milestone in the industry, still not there at 1 million qubits, but still significant.
There's a lot of progress. Don't sleep on quantum is all I'm saying. I love to hear it. Dave, what about you?
Yeah, let me set the context if I can. I mean, we all know where Google gets its money. It gets its money from search and ads, but Google, this year, our estimates are from theCUBE research that Google will do $54 billion in its overall cloud. And GCP, Google Cloud Platform.
That's significant.
Well, yeah, it is, and it'll be about 28% of that. And for the first time last year, Google started to make a profit. It was small, but this year, they're making around 15 to 20% operating margins. Now that compares to AWS at mid-30s, even high-30s. Azure doesn't report its operating margins, but I'm sure they're right up there. But the point is, for the first time ever now, by the way, Google overall cloud's growing at 30%. Google Cloud Platform.
That's a clip right there, yep.
Yes, Google Cloud Platform is growing significantly faster. So for the first time, Google Cloud Platform will cross over 50% of Google's overall cloud. Okay, so they're starting to make money. Where do you, and the reason I bring this up is because Google gets a lot of grief, right, for being number three. How many $54 billion businesses are out there? You're talking about a company that's the size, a business unit that's the size of Cisco, right? That's now starting to turn a profit, and they're spending, what, $75 billion this year on CapEx? So they're participating in, if you take the big three, about a $240 billion market. And it's rare, right? It used to be, tech used to be a winner takes all or most market.
Yeah.
Now this is an example where, the lead AWS and the other lead Azure, they're doing great, and Google, number three, is also doing great. And the last thing I'll say is AI has been a big tailwind for their business. If you go back to 2023 and look at Google's AI business, just from the ETR surveys, as a percent of AWS, it was around 70%. You fast forward to January 2025, it's up over 90%, and that has boosted Google's AI, and like you said, John, they got the full stack. Jensen even said it. Yeah. They have the best full stack for AI of anybody in the
business.
Remember
2 years ago when we were here, Savannah, you remember we said Google's next is a dark horse. We highlighted some of the critical analysis. Their operational scale up was challenging because Kurian was getting his sea legs, and they were kind of nipping at the heels and just eating the dust off AWS on the growth. But now you got Sundar Pichai on stage, which is a big notable thing. Forgot to mention that earlier, because what Google's doing is saying, no, we're flexing. So Google is seriously flexing. Sundar comes in, gives the whole Google vision, we're at scale, opening up to the enterprise, the networking. You start to see Google saying, hey, we're going to flex on our power. We always loved the nerd side of Google, but now they got the blocking and tackling done. They got the ecosystem, they got the marketplace under Steve Orban growing. You start to see those third-party ISVs on Google now. App Dev is in the keynote. Yeah. GKE was mentioned in the keynote. I've never seen Google mention Kubernetes to the level of prominence.
And Vertex.
Oh, without a doubt.
That was huge. So again, these are the things they had to do.
Yeah.
When we were saying, and they're not on a dark horse anymore, they're right there. And you see the adoption with AI, Dave, I agree. The product is going to be good.
Yeah, I want to jump in on what both of you are talking about here. And I think the big area of growth for Google right now is we're seeing in our own research that 94% of organizations are using two or more clouds. 65% are using four or more clouds. They have to adopt the multi-cloud, the hybrid cloud approach. GKE is a way to do this, right? To harmonize this across the platforms, make sure that's working. We're also seeing in our research that 20% of respondents indicate that application portability is critical for their organization. 67% say it's very important for them, right? And if they're doing this across multiple clouds, that's how they're going to grow. That's why I think in the last few years, you've seen this significant uptick in Google. I really hate to see that Google was like number three because, you know, it's always kind of the laggard to the hyperscalers in the US market, but it's definitely growing. It has that capabilities.
A lot of companies would take that position, I think.
Yeah, right? For sure.
Well, yeah, but I think what's kind of interesting though is it puts them in a unique opportunity where they can really focus on the ecosystem side of this. It's not just about, you know, the data coming from AI is only going to scale infinitely really over the next 5 to 10 years. So who is winning now, to your point, and I love the data you were sharing earlier, Dave, great context setting, is yeah, okay, so there was these winners in the first cloud run that we had, so to speak, but what's going to happen next is going to involve not only hybrid cloud, there's going to be a lot on-prem, yeah. And the reality is these full stacks, these ecosystem partners, we talk about it with Dell as well, it's going to be whoever wins that whole piece of the pie, not just these segments of it in terms of solutions, that's going to win in this overall game.
I mean, I think the ecosystem point, Sven, is right on, because if you're a full stack, you got to do a lot of things I call in between the toes, the details that no one sees. At GTC, we saw a couple big trends. We talked to Equinix, they have basically the footprint for kind of like the on-prem and edge. But at GTC, it was things like MV cache. It was very buried, but very key instruments around controlling the clusters. Here at Google, you heard things like Cluster Director, Anywhere Cache, Hyperdisks, Exapools, and then the pathways. You mentioned GK Inference Gateway, Pathways, which is distributed ML pipelining, powering Gemini. They're opening that up for multi-host inferencing. So at GTC, it was all about inferencing, power, and then ecosystem development. So I think if you're a full stack, you have to have ecosystem proof points, number one, and two, you got to do the hard shit that's in the systems. That's a huge deal, and they're doing it.
It doesn't matter if the developers don't use it. And I think a lot of this is going to come back to the developer experience, which is what I suspect you might have been ready to talk about.
The developers are going to use it, right? That's how it's basically being laid out. Firebase Studio was another one that came up, right? So the thing that I found very interesting, again, I'm going to go back, because as an analyst, I go back to my research, right?
And we love that about you, Paul.
You know, about a year ago, I ran a survey, and we found that 18% of production applications are using AI, right? We ran that survey 9 months later, that number jumped to 54%, and I guarantee you that number's much higher today, right? For all production-based applications. When you look at what Google announced with Firebase Studios and the ability to have that development effort eased of across these different platforms, using AI in the platform, that's going to be a differentiator, right? Because that's going to accelerate development and allow for that ease of use. When we talk about modernization efforts with CIOs, we see that the two barriers of entry for modernization is complexity and skill gap issues. That's what I was hearing in the keynote today, how to address complexity and skill gap issues, and that's where I think that Google is going to excel.
And don't forget, they have the eye candy too. They have the VEO2, and at the end he quoted and said, we are the only cloud that has all Gen AI and all modalities, which I thought was interesting. I'm like, I didn't check that because Amazon just made an announcement yesterday heels of this event. But again, back to the Google kind of doing the work. They're chopping the wood, they're carrying the water while scaling up the infrastructure. And again, the proof's going to be in Vertex and some of the cool consumer and enterprise stuff. And they actually intentionally said that. I don't know if you caught that. It's like, we're targeting the consumer and the enterprise.
Well, it's important because consumer is what drives volume, and it what drives adoption, and it lowers cost, and then it bleeds into the enterprise. We've seen that over and over and over again, but there's two other things that stood out to me. One was, they really aggressively recognized that not all AI is going to be done in the cloud. And they talked about NVIDIA, Dell got a small mention, and so they talked about sovereign AI and bringing the cloud, the AI, to the data on-prem, which I think recognizes that there is data gravity. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of data that's not going to go into the cloud. So that's a potential vector of opportunity. The second thing that I was notable by omission, I didn't hear anything, or very little, about security. Mandiant.
Interesting.
And the Wiz acquisition, now of course they probably can't talk too much about Wiz.
Yeah.
But security's another big play for them. Now I wonder, is it because they don't want to tick off some of their partners like Palo Alto Networks, who uses BigQuery for their AI security knowledge graph? So they didn't really get into security. Google has great security. And of course Amazon always starts with security. So I was surprised that they didn't play that up.
Security show. They buried it with compliance, sovereignty, that one kind of soundbite. Yeah. They kind of just buried it in one bucket.
And the Gemini agents as well, right? They talked about security in the Gemini agents as well. So there was a piece of it. I do want to come back to data sovereignty. What we're finding in cloud native research, right? We're finding that today, cloud native development is happening on-prem at 11% of respondents are saying this, right? But we asked them about the next 2 years where that development is happening, and 33% of organizations are going to do cloud native development on-prem. Right, that means they're repatriating back from the public cloud and bringing it back on-prem to do that. So this is a wise move for Google to think about where the development is happening.
Maybe it's not repatriation, maybe they're doing the development in the cloud, but they're bringing the AI to the data that's going to live on-prem. They're not going to move that data. See, I think the repatriation narrative is going to flip and turn to bring AI to the data. I think it's a more viable approach. Yeah, there's repatriation going on. Maybe 15% of the workloads are getting repatriated, but it's not big enough to offset the cloud. But I just want to make one more point. The skill set point is critical. If they don't have those skill sets on-prem, they're going to go to the cloud.
Yeah.
Dave, remember the Jensen's analyst talk we discussed? He said, still, most of the training and inference is done in the cloud.
Sure.
That's why they're pumping the on-prem. That's where the growth is. They have AI factories. Dell jumped on AI factories. So the question to you is, did you hear AI factory in the keynote today? I mean, I heard a little bit of it. Amin Vadat talked about the Ironwood. And it's interesting, they call it the AI hypercomputer. But he said this is something that we've been talking about on the keynote. He said, the chips are only one piece of the overall infrastructure, which acts as a system. The AI hypercomputing platform, that's basically their AI factory. I mean, they're basically not saying that word, but
it's a direct
overlay for NVIDIA, but yet they said, we got Blackwell and Vera Rubin coming. So clearly AWS and Google Cloud are leveraging NVIDIA and doing their own chips and leveraging their own resources. So the question will be, will the cloud get most of that bulk load on market share for the inference? It's going to be very interesting to see if the AI factory or this on-prem motion continues to happen. If they don't get software running on it.
Well, I think that's where that's a part of the ecosystem, in my opinion, is being able to do both.
So just to give you a sense, Floyer just quantified this in our research. And in 2025, the data center market, just for AI, the AI workloads, were $252 billion on-prem. Was like 15, this is 2025, $252 billion. On-prem will be $15 billion of that too. So it's a vast majority in the cloud. And the on-prem really doesn't kick up, really doesn't break $100 billion, which is still a big number, until the end of the decade.
I mean, are we in POC purgatory still? I mean, when do we break out of POC purgatory?
We are, because of the skills.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think to your point on, Savannah, on interoperability, the agent-to-agent announcement from Google Cloud today, that was something that kind of dovetails nicely into what you were talking about, the agent builder factory, right, and how they're interoperating these things together, right?
Yeah.
Having these applications talk to each other. This goes, Dave, to your point about security, right? You know, you got to think of IAM and MIM, right? And is that a way of the past, right? Is it these agents, the agent-to-agent approaches that are going to take over that security protocol?
Nir Zuk told me a week and a half ago, that everything we know about security has changed because of AI. He said, we used to be able to stop 99% of the attacks, and that 1% humans could deal with, but because of generative AI, it's impossible now. The adversaries can scale their phishing attacks so much. That 1% overwhelms the humans, so it has to, the only way to defend it is with AI. So everything has to be rethought.
If you're Palo Alto, Google's got now the Google WAN, Cloud WAN they call it, that's their network that they're offering to enterprises. Google's security is damn good. If you look at their security, they got billions and billions of users.
Yeah.
And so I would see a security reset. So I think security wasn't messaged mainly because they didn't want to take away from the show.
And they also have a security show. I mean, so I think there's...
Mandiant, right?
Yeah, I mean...
Well, they kind of collapsed it.
Didn't they bring it in?
No, they collapsed it.
So it's here, right?
Yeah. Mandiant
so
didn't
that's
happen
why,
this year.
Now maybe, it's day two. Maybe it's day two.
Remember Sunil Potti ran security?
I did not know
he's no longer with Google. Kevin Mandiant had left. And so that's a big void in the market. So maybe they didn't have their...
Because it was in October last year. Anyway,
and don't forget, this is only day one.
Right, I know.
Right, could be day two. Right,
there's a lot coming.
And maybe that's where they're going to focus on posture management and the whole threat intelligence, which Mandiant brings.
Absolutely could. One thing's clear from this conversation, we are going to have a lot to talk about all week with all of our fantastic guests. Dave, John, and Paul, no one else I'd rather do it with. Very grateful to share the week with you both and with all of our awesome guests. And thankful to all of you for tuning in wherever you might be. We're here in Las Vegas, Nevada at Google Cloud Next, day one. My name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.